So then, having taken up these chylomicron fragments, which essentially emptied out triglyceride balls that have just cholesterol remaining, the liver then does its magic and fiddles around and reassembles some other lipoproteins. And the lipoprotein it then produces is very low density lipoprotein, which you can see here. Now, this is produced from triglycerides that are in the liver and from cholesterol, and it reassembles another lipoprotein, VLDL. This lipoprotein is also atherogenic, small enough to get under the endothelial layer in blood vessels and to cause problems there. But it's not the only lipoprotein, because once VLDL is in circulation, again it's acted on by the lipoprotein lipase enzyme, which again removes the triglycerides and breaks them down to free fatty acids, releasing them so they can be used for energy by cells. That's useful, nothing wrong with that. Again, it leaves the core depleted of triglycerides. In other words, the core is much more predominantly cholesterol once the triglycerides have been broken down and released in the form of free fatty acids. And once that process has happened, what you end up with again is a smaller lipoprotein, because half of its core has been removed, which is mainly cholesterol, and because it's smaller, it is also atherogenic. So this is known as intermediate density lipoprotein, which also has the capacity to get under the endothelium and cause problems. And that can be further broken down. If that depletion of the triglycerides continue, then it becomes smaller and forms a low density lipoprotein, also of course atherogenic. Now notice here again, this intermediate density lipoprotein is shown with its little protein about to dock on to a receptor in the liver. This is basically telling you that at this stage, the intermediate density lipoprotein can actually be taken up into the liver and removed from the circulation, or it can be further acted on by lipoprotein lipase and more of the triglycerides removed until it ends up as low density lipoprotein. So either of those two things can happen. So we've got a number of atherogenic lipoproteins here. We've got VLDL, we've got IDL, and we've got LDL, all of which are atherogenic. In terms of the atherogenicity, in other words, the likelihood of creating atherosclerotic plaques, it's usually LDL that we hear about. And there's a reason for that, and that is although all of these lipoproteins have the ability to get under the endothelium and cause problems in the blood vessel, it's LDL which has the longest half-life in the circulation. LDL by far and away has the longest half-life. The reason for that being that although LDL possesses the proteins that can dock onto the receptors in, for example, liver cells, which can take these lipoproteins out of circulation, the affinity of the LDL's receptors for these liver receptors is much lower than that of the affinity between the IDL and the VLDL and the receptors in the liver. And therefore, VLDL and IDL are much more likely to be taken out of circulation because they will more readily bind to the receptors on the liver cells. How does LDL and the other lipoproteins, for that matter, cause the atherosclerotic plaque to develop? Well, here's a very simple diagram showing you the process. Now, first of all, let's clear up a misunderstanding which could arise at this point. When we're talking about the atherogenic effects of LDL, it's not actually true to say that LDL, low density lipoprotein, is atherogenic, because it's not. The normal LDL is not what causes the problem. What causes the problem is oxidized LDL. So when low density lipoprotein becomes oxidized, as it can if it's hanging around for a long time in the circulation, and what we're seeing here is these little round pink blobs are normal LDL, and these triangular ones are oxidized LDL. It's the oxidized LDL which tends to more readily find its way through the endothelium. Here's the endothelial layer here, and a little break, something slightly wrong with the endothelium at some point, and oxidized LDL around means that the oxidized LDL makes its way below the endothelium and into the smooth muscle layer of the blood vessel, and that's where it causes problems. So what we have here is a combination of some kind of damage to the endothelial lining of the blood vessel and oxidization of LDL, making it abnormal LDL, which then comes in under that epithelial lining and starts to cause problems. It sets off alarm bells ringing, and who always comes along when there's alarm bells ringing? Well, the good old white blood cells. Here's your monocyte macrophage system. The monocytes are attracted to the area because of the release of cell signaling molecules, cytokines and so on. They kind of smell the trouble and they come in the circulation and squeeze through the endothelium themselves. This is what these monocyte macrophages do. And because they're phagocytic cells, they come along and engulf the oxidized LDL, scrum it up, and they remain there under the endothelium, and they become engorged with oxidized lipoproteins, and they form what are known as foam cells, and they continue to release cytokines, which tends to keep the process going. It attracts more macrophages, they eat more of this oxidized LDL, and you get a big collection of foam cells, which is what forms the start of your atherosclerotic plaque. And as we know, this plaque then goes through various stages where it becomes worse and worse and more pathological processes occur. But this is what happens to start the whole thing off. The same thing can happen with VLDL and with IDL, but as I've said, it's LDL that's much more likely to get into this position because it's hanging around in the circulation for much longer. So it's important to remember that normal LDL has a perfectly good physiological function. It's actually taking packages of fats around to be used for the purposes of energy. No problem with that. Oxidized LDL is a different thing. I suppose it's a bit analogous to the situation where you have inadequate control of blood glucose, because blood glucose is there for a very good reason, and as long as you can control it properly, it's fine. When you have glucose hanging around in the circulation for too long because your control mechanisms are not functioning correctly, then you start to get sugars oxidizing, and that's when you get problems. And the same thing seems to happen with your fats. So we've talked about lots of lipoproteins and how they come about, but we haven't mentioned HDL, high density lipoprotein. Where does that come in? Well, that's kind of a separate system. It is, of course, also a lipoprotein. But this is, again, produced by the liver, but then it matures and fills up in the circulation. So what happens with high density lipoprotein is the liver assembles what is essentially an empty casing and releases that into the circulation. This is HDL. It has that same phospholipid and cholesterol outer coating, along with all of the requisite proteins that will act as docking stations and receptors and so on. Notice they're called apolipoproteins of various types. But it's released from the liver as an empty package, if you like. And then as it travels around the circulation, it goes to various cells and it gathers up cholesterol into itself and circulates that cholesterol back to the liver. So this is the one lipoprotein which is responsible for what is known as reverse cholesterol transport. In other words, in comparison to all the other lipoproteins which are transporting cholesterol to the cells, this one is taking it from the cells back to the liver. So it's taking cholesterol out of circulation. Now, for quite a long time, that was considered to be the main function of HDL, that basically it goes and docks onto cells which have lots of cholesterol, and it loads itself up with the cholesterol and takes it away from the cell and takes it back to the liver, which is a very good function because most cells don't have a mechanism for breaking down cholesterol. And cholesterol, like most things, becomes toxic when it gets to high levels in cells. So it's a very important function to have this little transport molecule that will come along and take away your potentially toxic cholesterol for you. And of course, it does this in many cells, but one of the cells that it does it in is the macrophages that we just saw are the ones that form the foam cells because they get engorged with the abnormal LDL. So HDL can actually come and take away that fat from inside the macrophages and therefore potentially prevent or at least slow the build-up of those atherosclerotic plaques. But what we have also discovered is that that's not the only good thing that HDL does. It does all these other fabulous things as well, all of which are protective. They add to the health of the circulatory system. So let's have a look at them. HDL seems to have antithrombotic effects. In other words, it tends to counteract the formation of clots, which becomes a big problem when your atherosclerotic plaque is fully developed, because you tend to have ruptures in the plaque and clots forming and breaking off and causing all sorts of problems. So HDL has an antithrombotic effect as well. It also has an anti-apoptotic effect. Now, apoptosis is the genetically programmed self-destruction that cells will undergo when they have been damaged, particularly when their genetic material has been damaged. And again, with respect to the blood vessels that are likely to become atherosclerotic, it tends to protect cells against dying. It also increases the production of nitric oxide, NO, by the endothelium. And nitric oxide has a number of effects. It's a vasodilator, but it also has anti-inflammatory effects. And it tends to stimulate the progenitor cells of the endothelium to affect repair of the endothelium. So all sorts of good effects seem to be stimulated by high-density lipoprotein. So it is the hero of the lipoproteins. So hooray for HDL. Now, this is a lovely diagram which I have included as a file for you to download, because it summarizes what we've talked about so well. The graphics are quite lovely. So it's taking you through from the beginning: intake of dietary fat is converted to chylomicrons, which is taken up into the lacteals, which then eventually empty into the bloodstream. And so you've got your circulating chylomicrons, which are then broken down by lipoprotein lipase to release the triglycerides from inside and to break them down to release fatty acids. And through that process, you gradually change from a large chylomicron to smaller and smaller lipoproteins, very low density, intermediate, and then finally low density lipoprotein. And here we've got the HDL in its empty form when it's released from the liver, and then in its full form after it's been round and sucked cholesterol out of the various cells and filled itself up with cholesterol, which it's then going to take back to be processed in the liver. And that cholesterol can then be excreted in the bile and removed from the intestine or recycled. Now, this diagram also has a little extra bit that we haven't looked at yet, and this is how a cell deals with LDL. So let's just have a look at that. So LDL in the circulation can actually be taken into various cells, because LDL, like these other lipoproteins, has receptors that allow it to dock onto cells. So it docks on and the whole thing is taken in to the cell in a vesicle. So what happens once the vesicle has been absorbed is it then is fused with lysosomes and the entire thing is broken down and the various components are released into the cell. So the fatty acids are released, the cholesterol is released, and even the amino acids are released from the breakup of the outer proteins of that LDL. That's a good thing. But notice what happens here. These little purple things are the receptors for LDL. In other words, these are the things that allow the LDL that's circulating to lock on and be taken in to this muscle cell. If everything's working as it should, then once you've dealt with that LDL, the receptors then return back to the cell membranes. The receptors are actually recycled. And so the cell is ready to take in more LDL. It doesn't get a gradual loss of LDL receptors. It maintains its level of LDL receptors because they are being recycled back. So the LDL gets processed, it gets broken down. You do get a buildup of cholesterol, of course, but you're hoping that HDL will come by and pick that up. The fatty acids you can use for energy, the amino acids you can use also. So everything's working fine and the receptors go back into the membrane to wait for some more LDL. So that's a very, very nice revision diagram.